The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. Almighty God,
to whom all hearts are open,
all desires known, and from whom no secrets are hid, cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name. Through Christ our Lord. Amen.
Glory to God in the highest, and peace to his people on earth. Lord God, heavenly King, almighty God and Father, we worship you, we give you thanks, we praise you for your glory. Lord Jesus Christ, only Son of the Father, Lord God, Lamb of God, you take away the sin of the world. Have mercy on us. You are seated at the right hand of the Father. Receive our prayer. For you alone are the Holy One, you alone are the Lord, you alone are the Most High. Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit, in the glory of God the Father.
Let us pray the collect of the day. Second Sunday after Epiphany, the theme assigned for our meditation is One Lord, One Baptism. Let us pray. God of new life, you seek to recreate people with holiness, justice, peace, and equality. We thank you for the institution of baptism, through which we could be touched by you and be transformed by you. Grant us grace that we who are baptized in Christ may realize that we are clothed with newness through the merits of Jesus Christ, the new Adam, who lives and reigns with you on the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Please be seated. The ministry of the Word of God. Now the Old Testament lesson will be read to us.
The Old Testament lesson is taken from the book of Numbers, chapter 11, verses 23 to 30. Numbers, chapter 11, verses 23 to 30. Is there a limit to my power? The Lord answered. You will soon see whether what I have said will happen or not. So Moses went out and told the people what the Lord had said. He assembled 70 of the leaders and placed them round the tent. Then the Lord came down in the cloud and spoke to him. He took some of the spirit he had given to Moses and gave it to the 70 leaders. When the spirit came on them, they began to shout like prophets, but not for long. Two of the 70 leaders, Eldad and Medad, had stayed in the camp, had not gone out to the tent. There in the camp, the Spirit came on them, and they too began to shout like prophets. A young man ran out to tell Moses what Eldad and Medad were doing. Then Joshua, son of Nun, who had been Moses' helper since he was a young man, spoke up and said to Moses, "Stop them, sir." Moses answered, "Are you concerned about my interests? I wish that the Lord would give his spirit to all his people and make all of them shout like prophets." Then Moses and the 70 leaders of Israel were back to the camp. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. Let us all stand for the reading of the psalm.
Psalm 23. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He maketh me lie down in green pastures. He leadeth me. He leadeth me rest field on green grass and leads me to quiet pools of fresh water. He gives a new life and strength. He guides me in the right path, and he has promised, "Even if I go through the deepest darkness, I will not be afraid, Lord, for you are with me. Your shepherd, rod, and staff protect me. You prepare a banquet for me where all my enemies can see me. You welcome me as an honored guest, and I will fill your cup to the brim. I know that your goodness and love will be with me all my life, and your house will be my home as long as I live." This is the word of the Lord.
Be seated for the epistle reading.
The epistle lesson is from Paul's first letter to the Corinthians, chapter 10, verses from 1 to 4. 1 Corinthians, chapter 10, verses from 1 to 4. Warnings against idols. I want you to remember, my brothers, what happened to our ancestors who followed Moses. They were all under the protection of the cloud, and all passed safely through the Red Sea. In the cloud and in the sea, they were all baptized as followers of Moses. All ate the same spiritual bread and drank the same spiritual drink. They drank from the spiritual rock that went with them, and that rock was Jesus himself, Christ himself. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Thanks be to God. Holy Gospel, Gospel according to St. John, chapter 10, verses 7 to 18.
Glory to Christ our Savior.
John's Gospel, chapter 10, reading from verse 7. So Jesus again said to them, "Truly, truly, I say to you, I am the door of the sheep. All who come before me are thieves and robbers, but the sheep did not listen to them. I am the door. If anyone enters by me, he will be saved and will go in and out and find pasture. The thief comes only to steal and kill and destroy. I came that they may have life and have it abundantly. I am the good shepherd. The good shepherd lays down his life for the sheep. He who is a hired hand and not a shepherd, who does not own the sheep, sees the wolf coming and leaves the sheep and flees. And the wolf snatches them and scatters them. He flees because he is a hired hand and cares nothing for the sheep. I am the good shepherd. I know my own, and my own know me. Just as the Father knows me, and I know the Father. And I lay down my life for the sheep. And I have other sheep that are not of this fold. I must bring them also, and they will listen to my voice. So there will be one flock and one shepherd. For this reason, the Father loves me, because I lay down my life that I may take it up again. No one takes it from me, but I lay it down of my own accord. I have authority to lay it down, and I have authority to take it up again. This charge I have received from my Father." This is the Gospel of Christ.
Praise to Christ our Lord.
While remain standing, let us sing the gradual hymn, "O Radiant Christ, Incarnate Word."
Oh.
Let us pray. Our most loving and gracious God, we praise you and thank you for another opportunity to come together as your people, worship you, adore you, and be strengthened by your word. Lord, as we reflect on your word, we pray that you would fill us with your Holy Spirit, so that we may discern your will and your purposes for us. Let the words of my mouth and the meditations of our heart be acceptable to you, our Rock and Redeemer. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Please be seated. St. Paul's letter to Ephesians chapter 4, verse 4 and 5. There is one body and one spirit, just as you were called to the one hope that belongs to your call, one Lord, one faith, one baptism, one God and Father of all, who is over all and through all and in all. Dearly beloved in Christ, greetings in the precious name of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. As most of you know, this is my and our family first Sunday in New Year. Since we were unwell, we refrained ourselves from coming into the church, but worshipped along with you virtually. So now the pastor also knows what it means to virtually worship God. And we praise God and thank God for the way God has touched us and healed us. And I must testify that there was never a moment where we had to panic, because we hear lots of things about, you know, what happens when you are affected by corona and even aftermath. But it was God's providential care and protection that we as a family have experienced during those times of isolation. Isolation from others. But since all of us were affected, we were really free in the house. So that was another grace, I must say. I remember, perhaps it was Barclay or one of the great commentators, a theologian, who praised God for being robbed. You know, the congregation came to know that the pastor was robbed while he was leaving the church and on his way to his house previous Sunday. And the next Sunday when pastor came, he said, "I thank God that I was robbed." And definitely there were smiles on the faces of congregation. Then he continued to say, "I thank God because I was never robbed before." So I did not know what it means to be robbed. So I have gone through that experience. So I thank God. He did not stop there. He went on to say, "I thank God for he has stolen just my wallet, but not my life. He could steal my purse, but not my life. And therefore, I really thank God and praise God." So we too have a reason to thank and praise God, though we were affected by Corona, but we have tremendously experienced the presence of God and the hand of God. I would like to thank the entire church for faithfully praying for us and for our healing. And I must say that it was your prayers that brought us healing. I also would like to thank some of our members who made special efforts to reach us and to help us during those difficult times. I thank Dr. Uday, Mr. Anoop, Mr. David Sam Roy, Mrs. Prema Christian, Mrs. Devaraj, Mrs. Hartwig, Noel Nicholas, and of course Rani, Philip, their son Karti and Sumant. All these friends were there to guide us, to help us, and to support us. I also would like to thank Reverend Muthunayagamaya, who took the responsibility of leading the worship services in my absence. And it was very painful that we could not be there on the covenant day, the January 1st. So it was a very important service. And afterwards, two Sundays to follow, Reverend Muthunayagam Ayya has taken up the responsibility and led the worship service. I immensely thank him. I thank the preachers who have accepted my invitation and shared the word of God in order to strengthen the congregation. I thank Right Reverend Dr. P. Sudaprakash, Bishop Garu, Reverend T. Bhaskar, the presbyter in charge of Clock Tower, who sent Reverend Rahul Edward with very short notice to come and preach the word of God on Covenant Day. So I also thank Reverend Rahul Edward, Reverend Rajshekhar, who have preached on the following Sundays. I also thank the organists, the choir members, who made the worship services very lively. I have many, as I said, many reasons to thank and praise God, but perhaps I would stop here, and I want all of us to focus on the theme that is assigned for our meditation today. The theme assigned for our meditation is One Lord, One Baptism. One Lord, One Baptism. In Paul's letter to Ephesians chapter 4, we see that Paul was trying to inspire the early church to have oneness of heart and mind, to have unity among them, because there were schisms. There were different gospels that were being preached, and as a result, church was divided. There were false prophets. There were heresies, false doctrines. So imagine, those were the early times, the formative years. And in those formative years itself, the church began to collapse. So it was a major concern for Paul, and he addressed it throughout his epistles. When he wrote to Corinthians, in the very first chapter and in the very first paragraph, he says, "I hear that there are divisions among you." You know, one says, "I belong to Paul." The other says, "I belong to Apollos." One says, "I belong to Cephas." And another says, "I belong to Christ." Then he raises a very pertinent question. Is Christ divided? Christ is not divided, and therefore, the church, which is the body of Christ, is supposed to have unity, because it is through our unity that we project Christ and Christ's love to the world around us. There were problems in the early church because the early converts were Jews. So for them, unless you are circumcised, you are not a Christian. You are basically to say, you are not part of this community. Just as we are circumcised, you ought to be circumcised in order to become part of us. But beautifully, Paul educated them, enlightened them by presenting the mystery of the gospel. In Ephesians chapter 3, verse 6, he says, "I want to present you the mystery of the gospel." The mystery of the gospel is that the Gentiles are the fellow heirs. The Gentiles are your fellow heirs, members of the same body, and partakers of the promise in Christ through the gospel. So this is the mystery. By the power of the gospel of Jesus Christ, you are transformed into one body. You belong to one community, that is Christ's community, where there are no divisions, where there is no hierarchy, where there is no status of high or low, no ranks, but all are equal. Now, once the World Council of Churches has come up with a concept that the church is not a square, but it is round. It's like a round table. When you sit at the round table, who is prominent there? Who is sitting at the prominent place? Every place is equal, and therefore everyone is equal. So church is like a round table, where all of us are equal because we are washed by the blood of Christ. We have the assurance of eternal life. We share the same faith and same hope. And that is why in just two verses, Paul used the word one seven times. Isn't it amazing? Isn't it striking to us that the writer was trying to convey to us very emphatically, and the emphasis is on oneness, and unity among the believers. We have one spirit. We are one body. We have one hope. We have one Lord. We partake in one baptism. And we have one God, the Father of all. And therefore, we are one. In Book of Acts, chapter 2, verse 36, Luke mentions where Peter stood up and said, "Let all the house of Israel therefore know for certain that God has made him both Lord and Christ, this Jesus whom you have crucified. You have crucified him, but God raised him to be the Lord of all and Christ for all." This word Lord for Christ, for Jesus Christ, is very important. Because in the Old Testament, the word Yahweh is replaced with Adonai in Hebrew, which means Lord. And therefore, even the psalmist had written, "Yahweh is my shepherd." The Israelites always said, "The Lord is my shepherd," because they considered themselves unworthy to pronounce the holy name of God. You know, that was the consciousness that the people of Israelites had. We are unworthy. We are unholy to take the name of the holy God. So they have put the vowels together and made the word Adonai, which means Lord. Yahweh is the Lord of the universe. He is the creator, sustainer, and the redeemer. And when we come to New Testament, again, Christ is introduced as the Lord. And this is the Christology of St. Paul. A new doctrine that Jesus is Lord of all. He is the Lord of life and he is the Lord of eternal life. Through him we are saved. Through him we have the hope of eternal life. Through him we become what we are called to be. We can lead our life worthy of our calling only with the presence of Christ in our lives. And therefore, Jesus also could say that I and my Father are one. And Jesus could say, as we read in the gospel portion, "I am the door." Nobody can go to the Father except through me. I am the door. And whoever enters through me will be saved. Whoever enters through me will be saved. They go out and come in and find pasture. They find life only in and through me. And in the responsive reading again, the affirmation of the psalmist, the affirmation of the Israelites, and the affirmation of every Christian is that Jesus is our Lord and he is our shepherd. He is the good shepherd. A good shepherd because he not only watches over, but he also lays down his life. So that through his death, we may find life. through his death, we may find life. Not only that, as a good shepherd, he knows the sheep. He knows our wants, our aches, our dreams, our fears. And therefore, when we affirm and acknowledge Jesus Christ as our Lord and as our shepherd, we lack nothing, as we read in Psalm 23. You lack nothing because he leads you into green pastures. And your cup will overflow, dear friends, as we have entered into the new year. Besides dreams and ambitions and goals, we also have some fears. We do not know what is in store for us in this year. So we have fears and anxiety. But here comes the assurance of God that you lack nothing and your cup will overflow. There is an also assurance that even though you walk through the valley of the shadow of death, you fear no evil. It is a false gospel if I preach and say, if you believe in Christ, no harm would come near you. You will have a very smooth life. But the true gospel is to share the hope of Christ and the assurance that God would walk with you. Even when you walk through the valley of the shadow of death, you fear no evil because his rod and his staff will comfort you. Because he is your shepherd, and because he knows you, you are led from condemnation into righteousness. Just as the psalmist says, he leads me in path of righteousness. So when God leads you in the path of righteousness, you will no longer be condemned, but you lead a righteous life. A life where you find right relationship with God and with one another. One Lord, one faith, one hope, one Spirit, one God, Father of all, inspires us for unity. Similarly, one baptism also inspires us for unity. Baptism, one of the two sacraments, has the efficacy. Unless it makes an impact on you, it is futile. So time and again, you must remember the sacrament through which you have gone, baptism and the Holy Eucharist. Of course, we have the privilege of partaking in the Lord's Supper week after week. So we are reminded of the significance of the Lord's Supper. But we seldom call to our mind the importance of baptism. So today, God reminds us that baptism is effective in your life when you realize its purpose. Your sins are washed away. You are grafted into Christ through baptism, and you become one with the fellow believer. It has this equalizing effect that you become one with the other in the body of Christ. In Romans chapter 6, verse 11, we read, "Consider yourself dead to sin and alive to God in Christ Jesus. Let not sin, therefore, reign in your mortal body." So the more you think of your baptism and the purpose of baptism, more effective your Christian living would be. Because it inspires and it challenges you to lead a true Christian life. Once a young girl approached the pastor asking for membership. She said, "I have received Jesus as my Lord and Savior, and therefore I am a new creation now. I am a new creature. I want membership." So this old pastor raised some questions. He asked her, "Were you a sinner before accepting Jesus?" She promptly said, "Yes, I was a sinner." And now this pastor asked, "So what about now? Are you a sinner now?" She said, "I am a bigger sinner than before." "How can it be?" So the pastor asked, "What is the difference it made in your life for accepting Jesus as your Lord and Savior?" She said, "Before my conversion, I was running after sin. Now, the life has changed. The sin runs after me. To drive away from God and God's love. So sin is always after me. I know it. And I struggle to overcome." She has promptly confessed. You know, just as someone said, either we are the unforgiven Christians or forgiven Christians. We are forgiven Christians or unforgiven Christians. Baptism inspires us to run away from sin because you are dead to sin through your baptism. You have been baptized into Christ Jesus that you might walk in newness of life. You know, many of us would say, "I am a born again Christian. I am a born again Christian. I am a new creature in Christ." Yes, the Word of God inspires us to lead a new life. But this new life doesn't mean that you simply refrain from bad things. You just do the good things. But it is more than that. So I would like to quickly place before you three things. One, when you are a new creature in Christ, when you have accepted the Lordship of Jesus in your life, and when you allow the purpose of baptism to have effect in your life, you integrate justice into your day-to-day life. You integrate justice into your day-to-day life. That means wherever you live, wherever you work, wherever you worship, you see that you lead a just life because you believe in a God who is a just God. There are no exceptions that only in the church I will be good. I will lead a righteous life only in the four walls of the church. No, there are no exceptions. You will integrate God's justice into your day-to-day life. Secondly, you will become a partner with God. God calls you to be his partners. In order to reveal God's love to the people around and even to renew God's creation. To reveal God's love and to renew God's creation, God calls you into partnership. Yes, we are unworthy to partner with God. Generally, partnership takes place between two equals, isn't it? You know, once my friend told me that he's a partner in business. His friend will invest and this man will run the business. So he called himself as a sleeping partner. I do not know whether it is a right word or a wrong word, whether it gives a negative connotation. Okay. So maybe we are called to be that partner, to run God's business in this world. And that God's business is loving the unloved, caring for those who are not cared, and transforming God's creation. Thirdly, building Christ's communities. Building communities where Christ is at the center, where Christ is glorified, where everyone would acknowledge the oneness of fellow believers, where unity is celebrated. Today, when we look at the situation around, where Christians are targeted, since we are a minority, we look very weak. But with the God of the universe, we are stronger than anybody. So what makes us strong is the presence of God in us and in our midst, and secondly, our unity. So today is the time where church needs to become one. You know, it is difficult to have common doctrines, common faith statement, because church is obviously divided based on the doctrines. But keeping aside all these differences, we must come together and become one as Christ's body. And someone rightly said, the need of the hour is to have aggressive unity. I like the word. Aggressive unity. As we face challenges, persecutions, and as the church and Christians are cornered, we need aggressive unity. A.W. Tozer once said, just as 100 pianos tuned to the same folk are automatically tuned to one another, we are drawn closer to each other when we believe in one Lord and have one faith and partake in one baptism. It is our unity and our worship that present to the world who we are. Therefore, dearly beloved, let us instore this message in our heart. Remove any kind of differences that we have and affirm the Lordship of Christ in our life and allow ourselves to have the sacraments play its role in affecting our lives to become transformed Christians in this world. May God add his blessings to the hearing of this message.
In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Let us all rise and affirm our faith in the words of Nicene Creed.
We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, one in being with the Father, through him all things were made. He came down from heaven by the power of the Holy Spirit. He was born of the Virgin Mary and became man. For our sake he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered, died, and was buried. On the day he rose again, in fulfillment of the scriptures, he ascended into heaven, as he sat at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory, giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son. With the Father and the Son, he is worshipped and glorified. He has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy Catholic and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come.
Amen. Please be seated. Now the announcements will be made.
I greet you all in the most precious name of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. A warm welcome to each one of you attending the service and also to those who are participating virtually. Holy Eucharist services will be held on Sundays at 8:30 a.m. All church services shall be streamed live. Sunday school classes are being conducted online. We request worshippers to observe the standard operating procedures issued by the Ministry of Health and Family Welfare, Government of India. Please maintain social distancing while occupying the church pews and also while approaching the Lord's table for the sacrament. Offering and other amounts received during the week: Sunday morning service 59,050, memorial service offering 1,000, tithe offerings from two families 6,700, monthly subscriptions 50,900. Special thank offerings received from
Ms. and Mr. Samuel Madhuka David, Sajeev Yeddu and Anupama, N. Philip Sagar, P. Samuel Albert, B. Vinod Kumar, Banyan John Prabhakar, amounting to rupees 23,000. The individual details of tithes and thank offerings received are placed on the notice board. We thank you for the offerings received and may God continue to bless you and your families as you offer for His glory. We specially thank the family who has donated rupees 1 lakh towards landscaping of the church premises. The church roll as on 31st December 2020 has been published and placed on the notice board opposite the main entrance of the church. Any objections, omissions may kindly be informed to the presbyter in charge within 10 days. Fresh membership cards are to be submitted by all members to enable updating of the church records. We request those members who have not yet submitted the same to do so at the earliest. Membership forms can be sent by email or handed over to Mr. M. James Samuel or to Mr. K. Sumanth Kumar at the church office between 10 a.m. to 2 p.m. Confirmation Sunday will be held on the 14th of March 2021. Members desirous of having their children admitted to the full membership of the Church of South India may contact our presbyter in charge. Confirmation classes will commence from the 24th of January. All members are advised to link to the official church WhatsApp group, and those of you who are not yet linked up may kindly contact our presbyter in charge or Mr. James Samuel. Altar flowers in honor and for the glory of God are donated by Mr. P. Samuel Albert. We regret to announce the passing away of Mrs. Arava Rachel Savitri, mother of our member Captain Johnson Manohar, during the week. Kindly uphold the bereaved family members in your prayers. May the departed rest in peace. We thank Mrs. Uma of Bharati Simmons, who has donated a clock for the church. I now request our presbyter in charge to kindly dedicate the clock. May the presence of the Almighty be with each one of you and keep you safe. God bless us all.
We thank Mrs. Uma for donating this clock to be placed in the church. May God bless her and her family. Let us pray. Our most merciful and gracious God, we praise you and thank you, for you are the giver of all good gifts. We pray that you will bless Mrs. Uma, who has donated this wall clock to be placed in the church. I pray, O God, that you would bless her family, protect them from all possible dangers and harm, and shower your manifold blessings so that they will testify to your wonderful deeds in their life. And now, as I bless and dedicate this wall clock, in the name of our triune God, I pray that your name be glorified. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, I bless and dedicate this wall clock for the use in the church and for the glory of God. I'm told that this was enabled through our member, Mr. John Manoj Katta. So I also thank him on behalf of all of us. The banns of marriage. I publish the banns of marriage between Chili Jadidia Sahas, son of Mrs. and Mr. Chili Daniel Raju, of CSI Wesley Church, Patancheru, and Koturu Sarika, daughter of Mrs. and Mr. K. Srinivasa Rao of the Indian Pentecostal Church of God, Hyderabad. If any of you know any just cause why they may not be joined together in marriage, you are to declare it in writing to the presbyter in charge of this congregation. Their marriage is scheduled to take place on 22nd January, and this is the third time of asking. Let us pray for Sahas and Sarika who seek to get married. Let us pray. Our most gracious and merciful God, our Heavenly Father, we ask for your blessings upon these your children who seek to be joined together in marriage. Prepare them, we beseech you, for this sacred union, and be their guide all the days of their life through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Let us continue to pray. Let us intercede for the church and for the world.
Let us pray for the church and for the world, and let us thank God for his goodness. Almighty God, our Heavenly Father, who promised through your Son, Jesus Christ, to hear us when we pray in faith. We give thanks for the church throughout the world, our own church, our diocese and bishop, Right Reverend Dr. A.C. Solomon Raj, and Most Reverend Rasalam Dharma Raj. Strengthen your church to carry forward the work of Christ, that we and all who confess your name may unite in your truth, live together in your love, and reveal your glory in the world. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We give thanks for the nations of the world, our own nation, and all men in various callings. Give wisdom to all in authority, especially the President, Prime Minister, Cabinet Ministers, and Chief Ministers of all states. Direct this nation and all nations in the ways of justice and of peace, that men may honor one another and seek the common good. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We give thanks for the local community, our families and friends. Give grace to us, our families and friends, and to all our neighbors in Christ, that we may serve him in one another and love as he loves us. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We pray for the sick and the suffering, for those who mourn. We give thanks and pray for all those who serve and relieve them. Comfort and heal all those who suffer in body, mind, or spirit. Give them courage and hope in their troubles and bring them joy of your salvation. Lord, in your mercy. We commemorate the departed. We commend all men to your unfailing love, that in them your will may be fulfilled, and we rejoice at the faithful witness of your saints. In every age, praying that we may share with them your eternal kingdom. Lord, in your mercy, accept these prayers for the sake of your Son, our Savior Jesus Christ. Amen.
Let us all stand for the summary of the law. Our Lord Jesus Christ said, "The Lord our God is the only Lord. You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind, and with all your strength. This is the first commandment. The second is this: love your neighbor as yourself. There is no other commandment greater than these."
Amen.
God so loved the world that he gave his only Son, Jesus Christ, to save us from our sins, to be our advocate in heaven, and to bring us to eternal life. Let us therefore confess our sins in penitence and faith, firmly resolved to keep God's commandments and to live in love and peace with all men. You may kindly kneel or be seated in an attitude of prayer and confess our sins before God. Let us say together, Almighty God, our Heavenly Father, we have sinned against you and against our fellow men in thought, word, and deed, in the evil we have done and in the good we have not done, through ignorance, through weakness, through our own deliberate fault. We are truly sorry and repent of all our sins. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, who died for us, forgive us all that is past, and grant that we may serve you in newness of life to the glory of your name. Amen. Almighty God, who forgives all who truly repent, have mercy upon you, pardon and deliver you from all your sins, confirm and strengthen you in all goodness, and keep you in life eternal through Jesus Christ our Lord. We shall say the prayer of humble access before partaking in the Lord's Supper. Now I request all of you to please stand for the breaking of the bread. We are the body of Christ. In the one Spirit we were all baptized into one body. Let us then pursue all that makes for peace and builds up our common life. The peace of the Lord be always with you.
And also with you.
While remain standing, let us share the peace of God with one another. The peace of the Lord be with you all. And let us sing the offertory hymn, songs of thankfulness and praise. And while we sing this hymn, let us honor God with our offerings. Friends, along with the general offertory, we have special thanksgiving for the many blessings that they have received in their lives. We have Mr. Subhash Desappa, on account of his birthday and for many blessings upon him and family, he offers thanksgiving to God. We have Marcus Chalumiel giving thanksgiving to God for celebrating a third birthday, for God's blessings upon him. We have birthday thank offering from Dr. P. Diviana Samuel. Birthday thank offering from P. Divij Samuel. Janice Kafira is celebrating the fourth birthday. On account of that, he expresses the thanks and offers thanksgiving to God. We have Bithia Stacy, on account of the birthday, offers her thanksgiving to God. Reuben George Kurvilla, celebrating the second wedding anniversary and offers thanksgiving to God. Rhea Melissa Kurvilla, celebrating second wedding anniversary and offers their thanksgiving to God. Joshua Kamal Kumar, on account of his 74th birthday, he offers his thanksgiving to God. And Katta John Manoj and Katta Kiran John, they praise God and offer their thanksgiving for their wedding anniversary on 22nd, and also for leading them and guarding them for the past 24 years. And Reverend James Cecil and the family members offer the thanksgiving to God for the healing and God's grace upon them. I request Reverend Muthunayaga Maya to offer prayer.
Let us pray. Almighty God, our gracious Heavenly Father, we come in front of your sanctuary, thanking, adoring, and magnify your glorious name you did in our lives. Lord, now we pray those who are celebrating their birthday and also their wedding anniversaries. Thank you, Master, we pray to bless them, grant many more happy returns of the day, and the family united in the holy matrimony, marriage. Grant good health and long life to see many, many happy wedding anniversary in their lives. Lord, now we pray those who are sick, especially you gave blessing, healing to Reverend James Cecil and his family, daughter, everyone, mightily Master. Now this is the time so much the disease is spreading in and around all over the world. Lord, we pray to protect. Thank you, Master, you protected Reverend James Cecil and his family and granted healing power bestowed upon. Almighty, we thank you. Holy Spirit, guide and strengthen them. The similar way, Lord, we remember other families. Heal them, touch them. Let them come to your presence thanking the marvelous things you have done for us. Also, we pray for other thanks offering. God loveth a cheerful giver. Whatever we received from thy hand, Lord, a part of it we are giving to you. Accept all the thanks offering, birthday offering, wedding anniversaries, and also healing wonderfully. And all we commit in your hand. Accept all these offerings. In the name of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, I pray. Amen.
It is our duty and our joy at all times and in all places to give you thanks and praise. Holy Father, Heavenly King, Almighty and Eternal God, through Jesus Christ, your only Son, our Lord, for he is your living word. Through him you have created all things from the beginning and formed us in your own image. Through him you have freed us from the slavery of sin, giving him to be born as man, to die upon the cross and to rise again for us. Through him you have made us a people for your own possession, exalting him to your right hand on high and sending upon us your holy and life-giving spirit. Therefore with angels and archangels and with all the company of heaven we proclaim your great and glorious name, forever praising you and singing.
Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might.
seated. Accept our praises, Heavenly Father, through your Son, our Savior Jesus Christ. And as we follow his example and obey his command, grant that by the power of your Spirit, these gifts of bread and wine may be to us his body and his blood. For in the same night that he was betrayed, he took bread. And after giving thanks, he broke it, gave it to his disciples and said, "Take, eat, this is my body which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." Again after supper, he took the cup. He gave you thanks and gave it to them saying, "Drink this all of you, for this is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me."
Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again.
Therefore, Heavenly Father, with this bread and this cup, we do this in remembrance of him. We celebrate and proclaim his perfect sacrifice made once for all upon the cross, his resurrection from the dead, and his ascension into heaven. And we look for his coming in glory. Accept through him, our great high priest, this our sacrifice of thanks and praise. And as we eat and drink these holy gifts in the presence of your divine majesty, renew us by your Spirit, inspire us with your love, and unite us in the body of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. With him and in him and through him, by the power of the Holy Spirit, with all who stand before you in earth and heaven, we worship you, Father Almighty, in songs of everlasting praise.
Blessing, honor, glory, and power be yours forever and ever. Amen.
We break this bread to share in the body of Christ. As our Savior has taught us, so we pray.
Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Do not bring us to the time of trial, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever.
As we prepare ourselves to approach the table of the Lord, let us say the prayer of humble access found on page number 6. We do not presume to come to this your table, merciful Lord, trusting in our own righteousness, but in your manifold and great mercies. We are not worthy so much as to gather up the crumbs under your table, but you are the same Lord, whose nature is always to have mercy. Grant us therefore, gracious Lord, so to eat the flesh of your dear Son, Jesus Christ, and to drink his blood, that we may evermore dwell in him and he in us. Amen. Draw near with faith, receive the body of our Lord Jesus Christ, which he gave for you, and his blood which he shed for you. Remember that he died for you, and feed on him in your hearts by faith and thanksgiving.
Jimmy. Fell down.
Having now received the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ, let us give thanks. Father of all, we give you thanks and praise that when we were still far off, you met us in your Son and brought us home. Dying and living, he declared your love, gave us grace and opened the gate of glory. May we who share Christ's body live his risen life. We who drink his cup bring life to others. We whom the Spirit lights give light to the world. Keep us in this hope that we have grasped, so we and all your children shall be free, and the whole earth live to praise your name, through Christ our Lord.
with the body and blood of your Son, Jesus Christ. Through him we offer your souls and bodies to be a living sacrifice. Send us out in the power of your Spirit to live and work for your praise and glory. Amen.
Let us all stand for the benediction. The peace of God, which passeth all understanding, keep your hearts and minds in the knowledge and love of God and of his Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be among you and remain with you always. Remain standing, let us sing the closing hymn, O blessed Creator of the light.
Oh, bless.
The Lord be with you.
And
let us depart in peace and serve the Lord.